am I audible? Hello?
Yes, yes, yes. Yeah, good morning.
Okay, okay. Hi, hi.
Rana. Yeah, hi. Hi, Anish.
So we will start at 10, okay?
Okay, okay.
You can just start, just sit for 5 minutes.
That okay, okay. That is fine, that is fine.
Alright, okay. Tell me about your project experience. What have you worked on and what are the projects you're using?
Okay, so in my project, we are actually working for JD Williams, which is a UK-based retail account. And I'm actually working for JD Williams like for 5.5 years now. means previously what we have, that is the monolithic architecture that we are having, that is on Hybris. And now for currently what we are doing, we are actually breaking down into pieces. We are actually using microservices using Spring Boot. So we are actually breaking down the functionalities that is currently in a development phase right now. And apart from my all my technical stats, I am actually a backend Java developer. And also we are using like Spring Boot microservices, as I told you earlier. And also like we are using Kafka for inter-service communication. And also you are using Git for versioning. And also we are using like Docker containers for building and testing purpose. And also for JUnit purpose, we are using like, means unit testing purpose, we are using JUnit with Mockito framework. And apart from that, for pipelines and all, we have like Jenkins script. And also like for DB purpose, we are using that AWS DynamoDB. That is like the all technical stack that I have been to. And for my responsibilities in my project is basically the backend development for developing the functionalities for our client, and also like the bug fixing, unit testing, and also we are following the agile, so we have like daily scrum calls and all. So we need to discuss about what we have done in the previous, or what we do next in the upcoming days. And also we create some Jira tickets and share among our team. So that is basically what I do.
Okay. So you got some rich experience in core Java then?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. So could you just tell me if the main method can be overloaded anyway?
Main method. Yes. Main method can be overloaded. Right.
Okay. And how do you invoke the overloaded main method?
That is like the only like public static void main. So in order to call that overloaded main, just you need to have like, that is the static method basically. So it is actually part of the class, not the object. So by just dot operator, you can actually call it from outside, or you can just call it from inside.
But whenever we are calling the main method, it will directly go to one of the main methods, right? How does Java understand which main method is first? Just that we can overload it, right?
Yes. So for that means overloaded means you have like different sets of parameters or different data types of parameters that you are having. So you are calling that main method, not the main method which is like string array with ARGs.
Okay. And what is the
main
method when you call main method from within the main?
Can't understand. Can't actually.
My question is. Yeah. You're able to hear me, right?
Yeah.
My question is, what happens if I call a main method from within another main method?
Okay. Main method you're calling that main.
So that's my question, right? So
you have
a main method. Mm-hmm. So within that I call main method. Which main method would get called then?
Probably the main method which is actually responsible for the program running, that is being called. So running the Java application, that method will actually called.
So it will be calling itself is what you mean?
Yeah, I think so. Means have not actually tried that, but means by logically I think so.
Okay,
let's see.
Is null an object in Java?
Yes, null is object. Null means you can have null. Just a moment. Null is not the object in Java. Means if you let's say you have one method that is having like string type of argument which is taking, and you can send there as null. So null is not the object. I think null you can send as a means is a blank string basically. Means it's not the blank string, but it's the it's not the object basically.
Okay. Tell me something. I'll just give you an example. Let's say there are two methods. Okay.
Okay.
And method one. Let's say the method name is the same. Okay. And one takes instance of object, and another one takes instance of string. Okay.
Okay.
And from the main, I call that method, and I pass null in it.
Okay.
Which one will be invoked? The one with the object or the one with the string?
No, one with the string will invoke.
And why is that?
Because you are passing that null, because null is not the object. Null is basically is a part of the string, so it will actually call that method which actually having that string.
But in this case, I'm just cross questioning.
Okay.
String belongs. The mother class of all classes is object, right? String is also, if you look at the class hierarchy, object is at the very beginning. After
yes,
within
yes.
From within string originates, right?
Yes.
So in that case, null. If it's a null, then automatically, if it is a string, it is in object an object as well, right?
Okay. Okay, means I think actually that will go by the hierarchy. As you are actually passing that null, then if there is present a string, then it will actually go to that base level. Then after that, it will go to the parent level. So that is the case.
No, I didn't get your answer. Then For your
scenario, you are passing null, and you have like two same method, that is the overloaded method, and one is having the object and one is having one string. In that case, the string method will call that I can tell you, but means string also has the parent of object, means parent is basically the object. So and in that case, what I can actually tell about that, it will actually call the less hierarchy, means the less position. If it matches, then it will actually not go for the higher one.
Okay. Good.
Anish, just 1 minute. Can I just switch my fan, because I am not able to hear you properly.
Okay, go ahead.
Just a moment. Actually, yeah. The noise is very much loud.
Okay. So it's better now?
Yeah. I'm all done.
Alright. Yeah, tell me something about autoboxing and unboxing in Java.
Yeah, autoboxing is basically like, it actually uses the wrapper class, means let's say you have like integer. Integer I equal to let's say 5, and auto boxing means you are setting that into a primitive data type. Let's say int a equal to, you can simply put I over that. You don't need to have like integer dot parse int, then you put that I. So you don't need to parse that. You just assign that into a primitive type. That is like the auto boxing. And unboxing is the different thing.
So you want to say auto boxing is the conversion of from the wrapper class to the primitive type? Is that auto boxing for you?
Vice versa. Means the same goes for the means you can have like int I equal to 5. Then if you have like integer some object, then you can actually directly assign that I. You don't need to like integer dot parse int or something.
I get that. Just tell me something, like if you have to convert from the wrapper class to the primitive class.
Okay.
Right. So what to call it? Is it autoboxing or is it unboxing?
It is unboxing.
Okay, from the wrapper to the primitive, it's called unboxing.
Yes. from the wrapper to the primitive is just a moment. I'm not confused.
No, it's okay.
From primitive to means wrapper, it's boxing. Means you can do boxing or unbox auto boxing, and for like data means object to a primitive, that is the unboxing, or you can do auto unboxing as well.
Okay, sure. Do you have any experience with the Java garbage collector?
Not much, but I know something. Means we can actually call it from like system.gc, but that only I know. It actually clears the unreferenced variables or some dangling operators that we have in our in Java. Mainly JVM actually does the job.
Okay, so that's the I get it. So do you think GC would always prevent a Java application from going out of memory?
Honestly speaking, I actually don't know.
Okay, we'll move to the next question. Can you differentiate between pass by value and pass by reference?
Pass by value and pass by reference. Okay. Just a moment. Reference is basically that that location it is pointing, let's say you have defined one string A equal to, let's say, ABC, then it will actually hold one reference, which actually that is holding the value of ABC, and A is actually pointing to that reference, so if you call by the reference, then you will actually get that ABC. But if you change something to the A, means let's say you have previously string A equal to ABC, now you have changed that string A equal to ABC plus BCA, that reference will be different. As the string is a immutable class, the reference will have a different, then you will have like A equal to ABC, it is pointing to that next reference. But in that previous reference, which A equal to ABC, which is also already there, so I can think about if you call by value, it will actually means you can get like ABC or ABC BCA, but you can, if you call by the reference, also it will also get the same.
Tell me something. I'll just just give you a small snippet. Okay, just tell me what the output would be. Okay. Got the message, right? Just open chat.
Okay. Yeah.
What will be the output?
Yeah. Only just one question, is that the OR operator, means we can have like a double dash into it?
Well, that is for you to find out. Assure you that this is a compiled code, so
okay, fine. I think Z will be valued as 2 for this. No, no, just a moment. It will actually perform this as well. Check and plus 5 x equal to y, that is minus 2, x is less than y plus y. We actually increase that y value with 1, so y is now 2 and x is now 1, and z is 3. Z is 3 for this. Hello. 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 Sorry, Anish. I actually got disconnected.
Yeah. I think there was some problem with
the software. Yes. No. So for this, what I can think about, the Z valued will be 3. 3 will be 3 will print.
Okay. And what about the inclusive OR operator? How does it work?
That is like the inclusive OR operator. What I can think about the OR operator actually works is like this. If something you have checking that x equal to y, if that is like true, then it will actually not check for the rest of the thing. But if you have like the AND operator, then it will actually check both of them.
If that is true, then how did you come to the output key?
No, I'm actually totally confused that the output will be 2. Sorry for that. The output will be 2.
Okay, sure. Just tell me something. You are aware of the finally block, right?
Finally block, yeah, right.
Okay, let's say your code has a finally block, okay?
Okay.
And there is a try catch block as well.
Okay.
Now, what if, let's say your try catch block is already handling the thing and you do not want the finally block to be executed?
Okay.
You are trying to skip the execution of the finally block. How would you design the code?
If I simply do break.
Does break ensure that finally is not executed?
Even though return is also ensure that the finally will be executed. Even though if I do some return statement in the try block, then also it will actually do the performance of the finally block will be executed. I'm just now assuming that what will be the case. Sorry, I will not take longer, but I actually don't know.
Never mind. Just tell me something. Have you worked with certain?
Sorry?
Have you awarded certificates?
Certificates?
ESO or Trust Award?
No. I have
no.
Not
for example,
sorry.
You are, let's say you are exposing your service over over the SSL, right?
Yeah.
So you would require certificates to, you know, at a transport security layer, right?
Yeah. Okay. That certificate. Yeah. We have actually used like Spring Boot security for this. So what we basically do, we actually create that JWT token and send that JWT token in the as a response. And if we will go to the next service with the authorization header, then from that the service actually checks that the token is valid or not, or the token is expired or not. In that way, it actually permits the user to use that API or give the get the response.
Okay. Could you just tell me the, what all do you send in the JWT?
Yeah, mainly what we do, let's talk about our application. So what we basically do, we have like one user management services there. So in that user management service, what we pass the username and password. And in that user management
No, it's okay, Rana. What I want to know is, could you just define me the structure of the JWT?
Okay.
Do you send any certificate in data in there?
We create the JWT token with some algorithm. I exactly not remember the algorithm right now. That is the H5 something like that, the algorithm we use, and we create the JWT token for that. And in that JWT token, it actually consists of like three part. One is first part is the algorithm what you have used, and second part is actually holds the username and the expiry time, and next is actually holds the authorization, means authentication.
What do you send in the authentication?
Exactly not remembering it right now.
Okay.
There's a long code I remember, but where we have used like the algorithms and all, exactly the structure I don't remember it right now.
No issues. Have you worked with mutual on your system, on your application?
Mutual? Sorry?
Mutual authentication. Like there's one way and there's two way, right? So have you worked on two way SSL?
No.
I'm not. Okay, no issues. Could you just tell me what Spring Cloud is?
Yeah, Spring Cloud, we have actually used the Spring Cloud config server in our application. So what we actually do means we have like the setup properties which are actually common for the all the microservices that we are using. We have actually created another service which is the Spring Cloud config server, and in that server we service we actually set it all the properties, and from that server what we actually do, we actually get that in the service level and use that actually properties in the service. We need to configure the Spring Cloud config server in that one, and also we have to configure the Spring AOP as well to refresh it.
Okay, I'm just going to give you two conditions. Just tell me what would be the output of it. Okay. Whether true or false.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, in this condition 0.1 to 3. looks like identical.
Almost, they are almost identical. What do you think?
I think about true, but I'm actually guessing that what will be the actual answer. If it's true, then it actually not comes in, like in the interview question.
Yes, then why am I asking, right?
That is also I think about, but I just.
Any guesses?
I can guess that the first one is false and the second one is true.
And why do you think?
Sorry, Anish.
It's okay. No issues.
Can you please tell me this means?
you can Google it.
Okay. I'll Google it.
Something to do with floating point. Significant digits.
Okay.
But your guess was right.
Okay.
I'm just going to give you. Let me see. Could you just tell me this? Just a second. Let's say you are working with Spring Boot and you have to change the default port of Axon. Okay. Which property file do you change?
Now,
what is the configuration?
Means you want to change the port of the service.
The default port of the Tomcat server, right? Okay. On which the application is running.
So
my question is, which configuration do you change, and where is it? I mean, where would you find it?
So mainly we can actually change from the application.properties or application.yml YML file. You can just put that server.port and you can give like whatever port you want. But in case of like using the application.yml file, you need to have like indentation. You need to follow the indentation, that server, then next line. You need to give some spaces, then port. In this way you can actually change the port.
Okay. Now what is the configuration in application.properties? Could you please repeat?
Server.port.
Okay, fine. And how can you make changes in the log level? Let's say I want to change the log level to debug. Application.properties file only, let me tell you that.
Okay. Actually, never used in our application. We have like separate logging service we have created. I think it will actually do something with the log4j.
Do you have an idea of Singleton Plus?
Yes.
How it works?
Yes.
Okay, tell me about it.
Yeah, singleton class is basically like whenever you are running the Java application in that runtime, it will actually create one single instance of that class. You can get only a single instance of that class. So in order to do that, what do we have? Like you don't have like public constructors. So someone cannot actually create with the public constructor and create one instance. We have like the private constructor, only one method that is public, that is the public static get instance method. And in that get instance method, what we actually check? We actually check for the null, the instance is null or not. If the instance is null, then we are actually creating the new object and send it to the and send it. Otherwise, we actually send the same instance. So this is like the singleton class we have, and if you make this thread safe, so you can actually use that synchronized keyword in the get instance method to make it like properly usable in the multi-threaded environment as well. Otherwise, okay, it will actually give you like two instances of the singleton class.
Okay. Do you have an idea of using how to use Git?
Yes.
Okay. Tell me the difference between Git pull and fetch.
Git pull actually what it actually do means in that branch, means whenever you're pulling from that, you are actually pulling in that branch or it's anything change or not. But when you are fetching from that, means fetch from the origin, what you actually do, if something apart from that branch is present, then everything is fetched in your local. Let's say... Let's say I'm giving one example. Let's say I'm now pointing at the develop branch. Okay. Now I'm changing something in the develop branch, and someone also changed something in the develop branch. Then we actually take the pull, and from the develop branch we actually got that the new version of code. But in order to, let's say you have created another branch from that, someone actually created one another branch from the develop branch, and then if you not fetch from that, then you cannot change to that new branch as well, because the pull actually pulls from the origin, just means pulls from the branch, not everything what apart from that pulls only the code basically.
So git fetch does not do any kind of file transfer, is what you think?
File transfer.
Yeah, my question is, does git fetch involve any kind of file transfer from the remote to the local?
Yeah, it will actually means if you are fetching that, it will actually do everything, means pull and fetch everything.
Then no, if I use git fetch, right?
Okay.
Would it kind of fetch any kind of file from the remote to the local?
Not exactly local. If you fetch from that, then you need to pull. After you pull, then only you can actually get the new file. Otherwise,
If you take fetch just as it is, it does not pull any kind of change. You have to explicitly do a pull, right?
Yes.
Yeah. That's what I wanted to know. Okay.
Actually, we do from the Eclipse as well. Means Eclipse Git. Right.
Okay. So you are experienced more in Java 8, right?
Yes. Or
the previous?
Java 8 mainly. Yeah, I have experience.
All right. Okay, fine. I think that will be all, Ranak. I have got the questions answered already. So I think, I'll just let my feedback to the HR, and that person will get back to you then. Yeah?
Okay. Thank you, Anish.
You have any questions from your side?
Actually, I have the questions what are the technical person you are wanting basically, and what are the projects that you are having? That is from the same technical stack that we are looking for, like Spring Boot microservice.
Yes, primarily we are looking for Java and microservices.
Okay.
So Spring Boot is an add-on that is good to have.
Okay.
And primarily this kind of the drive is for the BFS. So
Okay.
Banking and consulting. Okay.
Okay. So, and just one last question. Means is there anything means now what we are actually having in our current organization? We have like separate team for separate thing like for say we have like different people for the front end thing and different people for the back end thing. So is there any possibility to make it for means using for a full stack developer or getting into chance means what you are looking at?
Yeah, that specifically is a project requirement. So okay. I think if you are able to prove your prowess in the entire tech stack mm-hmm. area, then definitely you will get an opportunity.
Okay.
But as far as I know, it's primarily in a development of Java with microservices.
Okay.
Now, if you are talking of a full stack developer, then you know the project that you will be assigned in,
mm-hmm.
maybe the project manager would be able to give you some kind of position like that.
Okay. I am actually learning the front end as well. I mean, that is apart from that we do actually in TCS beginning.
Uh-huh, that's good to know, because definitely that might come of use to Cognizant as well. So
okay.
Yeah. All right. Okay. Thanks okay. a lot, Rana.
Yeah, thanks,
the HR will get back to you.
Okay. Thanks, Anish. Right. Yeah. Bye.
Bye. Take care. Cheers.